The San Francisco Public Library presents the 11th Annual Unsung Hero Awards.
If something can't get us started, that's it. Good afternoon, and welcome to the Unsung Heroes program. I'm Regina Minudri, and I'm the city librarian, and I just love it. One of the things I love is being able to come to programs like this. It is a real pleasure to be here on the 11th year of this very special program. The Unsung Heroes Awards program started at the Western Edition branch in 1998 through the inspiration of librarian Joan Jackson. Joan, by the way, is now enjoying her first year of retirement. And the Golden Gate chapter of the National Council of Negro Women, which has supported this program throughout its life. Today, our community has broadened. The Unsung Hero Awards program is now supported by several of our libraries, including the Bayview Annawadden Branch, Ocean View Branch, Potrero Branch, and the African American Center here at the Main Library, in addition to Western Edition Branch. I would like to thank and acknowledge the staff who have made this afternoon's program possible, including Linda Brooks Burton, Robert Carlson, Dorothy Coakley, Amy Holloway, and Toba Singer. I am proud to be here this afternoon to meet the unsung heroes from all over the city, this year's award winners, as well as those from past years. Those of you who have given so much to your community without stopping to ask for thanks or recognition. We are truly grateful to you because you have improved the lives of others and your community through your dedication and your hard work. We are appreciative that you have chosen to be with us today at the San Francisco Public Library. Now, I know there is another person here this afternoon who would like to extend his good wishes to our unsung heroes and to all of you joining us today. It is a pleasure to introduce to you someone who really needs no introduction, the Honorable Willie L. Brown, Jr., Mayor of San Francisco.
To our librarian, thank you very much for that very kind introduction, and thank all of you for that very warm reception. When I saw on calendar the names and the exploits of those, reference to the exploits of those who were being honored today, I wanted to come by and have the city acknowledge, as well as the sponsoring organizations, the great respect and appreciation that must always be shown to those who go beyond their own normal responsibilities to do something for other people, or they have chosen a profession or an operation or a position that represents something very special for other people. And on this day, when they join that group of persons who've been previously honored, you too will know exactly what those honors are for and why, and I think you'll understand how grateful the city is. A city is a place where people live in close proximity to each other. The closer we are together, the more we have to be concerned about each other, whether we want to be or not. And how well we discharge that function and that obligation will dictate whether or not the quality of life in our city is that worth living for, that worth always wanting to be a part of. These unsung heroes make that possible in the city and county of San Francisco. So I am delighted to join in this tribute. Now, I've been asked to do one more thing. I do not sing. Don't applaud. But the librarian has asked me to lead, lift every voice, and sing. I do intend to accommodate that request, but this is not a solo. This is for us to do it together. Now, there's got to be one outstanding voice among you who would love to join me here and sing a duet with the mayor on Lift Every Voice and Sing. There's got to be at least one outstanding. Come on up. Come on up here. Come on up here. I got two. Come on up here. Come on up here. And now, would you kindly stand with us, please. One on one side, one on the other. One on one side, one on the other.
Oh.
We're going to do it right here. We're going to do it right. So, right. Well, what am I?
All right. Lift every voice and sing till Rise, hot as a
Thank you.
For the young people in this, on this day, you must take this home with you if you have not committed the words. Those words should be with you. I was raised in Mineola, Texas, as you know, in a separate but equal school system. We learned the Negro National Anthem, "All Lift Every Voice and Sing," as we politely call it today, before I learned the Star Spangled Banner. And I know all of the verses to "Lift Every Voice and Sing." You should learn at least the first stanza of "Lift Every Voice and Sing." Believe me, you see those two ladies? They did it without reference to notes or anything else. And I wasn't about to start peeking. Even if I forget one word. But it is well worth it because it has a rich history behind it. The history as rich as the awardees' performance today. Thank you and congratulations to all the honorees.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We appreciate your gracious presence here today. Now I'd like to turn the program over to Linda Brooks Burton, our librarian at the Bayview-Wadden branch. Linda?
Greetings, and welcome to the 11th Annual Unsung Hero Awards. It is my honor to welcome you to a program that recognizes people who do so much for our communities, yet they have received little or no recognition for their accomplishments. You will be listening to some wonderful stories of unselfish acts and unwavering commitment. When you leave here today, you will be inspired with the knowledge that good people do exist and that they are all around us. At this time, I would like to introduce. Throughout the program, we will be having three different people come up to present awards to our unsung heroes, Veronica Dangerfield, Tamika Davis, and Donald Ray Young. So I'd like to introduce to you our first MC, Veronica Dangerfield. Thanks.
And I say to you cousins, good morning. Am I here by myself? I said, cousins, good morning.
Good morning.
I tell you, you are looking so beautiful today, even more beautiful than last year. Why don't you turn around to your other cousins and say hello briefly? Hello. Yeah. We are here to celebrate. Come on. All right. God bless you all. You look wonderful today. If you are blessed today, say ashe.
Ashe.
If you know that we're doing a wonderful thing today, say ashe.
Ashe.
And remember to smile, because we're having a good time today. All right. You know, there's a Swahili saying that one man cannot launch a ship, but I'm here to tell you that one woman can. And this woman's name is Betty J. Baham. She's a person who is warm, caring, hardworking, honest, kind, considerate, and very patient. She's a person who loves children and her peers. She's a woman of sharp intellect. Ashe for a woman of sharp intellect?
Ashe.
Ashe. A warrior for all students who are disadvantaged, an unequal leader in youth employment in San Francisco, particularly for at-risk youth. Now that's an ashe for me. God bless you, Betty. She's an educator from the heart who believes in preparing young people's minds so that they may succeed in life and follow their dreams. Thank you. I heard a miscellaneous ashe. Thank you. Thank you. You know, us black people, we come from a oral tradition. We don't ever sit down and be quiet. So you guys feel free, okay? Okay, these are some of the statements that are made by our nominated Betty Baham. She's our unsung hero in 1999. Miss Baham has been a public school teacher for the past 30 years. Now, I've taught seventh graders for 1 hour, and to do it for 30 years, God bless you, lady. She's helped young people in the classroom and beyond, spending long hours after work. Y'all didn't hear me. I said after work. She is the director and founder of the Emmanuel Achievement Program, a tutorial school for grades 1 through 12. This school meets every Saturday throughout the year. How many of you volunteer on Saturday to tutor kids? Sounds like a great idea to me. Ashe. The volunteers donate their own money for books, supplies, and lunch. These services have been provided for the last 10 years with a lot of success for all who attend. So please, everybody, put your hands together. Give me a warm welcome for Betty J. Baham. Please come up, Ms. Baham.
My sincerest gratitude to the National Council of Negro Women and to the Friends and Foundation of the San Francisco Public Library. For the most part, my professional career has evolved with at-risk youth, and this has been by choice. My children, my daughter, my son, and my daughter-in-law are also teachers in the San Francisco Unified School District. I am extremely proud of them. I would like to say that in 1989, five members of the Emmanuel Church of God in Christ organized the Emmanuel Achievement Program. This is a Saturday tutorial program which serves grade levels 1 through 12. We provide a free lunch to the students at the end of each session. We provide all the materials free of cost. And the program is staffed by the directors and a dedicated core of volunteers. We also, during the year, have at least three parent workshops for parents and for students. And this is collaborated with the STEP School to Career program, which is funded by the Private Industry Council of San Francisco. We have as a consultant a former manager of the school psychologist of the San Francisco Unified School District's Special Education Department. The program originated also as a response to Dr. Martin Luther King's ideals and his life. We thought that after everything that he had done in his life, that we could make some effort to do something to help our young people. The program is generally a little underfunded and sometimes understaffed, but we are aware that we are making an impact on the lives of young people. We get the feedback from them, and so we feel very positive about what we're doing. We would like for our children who experience the EAP program to come away with at least three concepts. One of them is that you're loved. The second is that God loves you. And I think one of the most important things that we try to instill in our children is that only you can define you. No one else. This is your right. This is what you do for yourself. We like to empower our children with that. We have also been blessed with a number of donations from our church and so forth and the support. But truly, this program is funded and is run on the generosity of its founders and the volunteers. Sometimes getting up on a Saturday morning is a little difficult to do. But I think over the years, we have looked upon it not as a duty, but as a privilege. It is wonderful to get the feedback from our parents and our children. I think we get more out of it than they do. And so on behalf of the founders of this program, and I'm not sure how many of them are here today, but if you are here in the audience when I call your name, would you please stand? Mrs. Dorothy Levy, Mrs. Bernice Brown, mm-hmm. Mrs. Harrison and Reverend Harrison, who is deceased, and to our newly inducted director, Mrs. Marjorica Dickey. I'd like to accept this award on their behalf and my sincerest gratitude, and I accept this award with great humility. Thank you so much.
Can we please give one more hand for Betty? There's a saying in Nigeria that a man's deeds are his life. We're talking about Mr. James J. Byrd here. This is a man who in April of 1998 stepped to the plate to accept the position of the president of the San Francisco African American Historical and Cultural Society. Nobody wanted to step up to the plate. One man stepped up to the plate. Can I hear an ashe somewhere in this building? All right. Yeah, I ain't gonna fall asleep on me, okay? Okay, Mr. Byrd faced a situation in which membership and other records were not available, and the status of the society was not known and could not be immediately determined. But Mr. Byrd's integrity and great tenacity, along with his personal generosity, enabled the doors of the society to remain open. This new president has a history with the society since 1977 and has served many years as a long-term volunteer on the board as a treasurer. If anyone in this building thinks that it is important for San Francisco to have an African-American historical and cultural society, can I hear an ashe?
Ashe.
All right, that was resounding. Y'all getting better. Jesse Byrd's character was formed by his parents' 13-acre farm, a 5-mile walk to the school he attended. They didn't put barefoot in the snow here, but I imagine it's something like that. He's a native of Woodville, Mississippi. He grew up there and in New Orleans. He attended the City College in Los Angeles and San Francisco, and San Francisco State University. A San Francisco police officer, he retired in 1980 as a solo motorcycle patrolman for the San Francisco Police Department. I give you an ashe, Mr. Byrd. Mr. Byrd, I'm not finished talking about you yet. I'm getting into it now, Mr. Byrd. I'm almost ready for you. He's married with 5 children, 9 grandsons, and 1 granddaughter. Wow. Ashe. It's here for reproduction, folks. Mr. Byrd is a wrestler, a football player, and a basketball enthusiast. He enjoys gardening and cooking, and you should make friends with Mr. Byrd because his specialty is greens and baked fish. I'll be over round 5, okay? Let me in. Mr. Byrd, we take pride in saluting you, sir. We wish you continued success as you express this pride in the race through your dedicated service to the San Francisco African American Historical Cultural Society. Come on down, Mr. Byrd. It's your turn now.
I would first of all like to thank Mrs. Morrison, Mrs. Johnson, Melody Morton, and Miss Amy Holloway, who helped make this award possible by submitting my name in nomination. And most of all, I would like to give thanks to my family, who has been supportive of me. And I would also like to take this opportunity to encourage especially my grandsons. I have a granddaughter, she's doing great in every aspect of life, academically, athletically, et cetera. But my grandsons need a little bit more encouragement. And I'm trying to instill in them that life's a two-way street. It's not all about give me or getting, but about giving. giving is just as important as receiving. And I just hope that they would take note and try and apply some of the advice they've been getting from other members of the family as well. And I also think that the society is a great institution, one that I've had great respect from since the first time I became involved with it. I guess it was in the late 60s, but more active from 73 on up until this date and time. And we should not, as a people, have done to this institution what was done by the previous board. And we still not out of the woods, so to speak, as of yet. Therefore, I request that each member that's present in this assembly become a member to help us save such a great institution. And not saying anything further, I would just like to leave you with the word that in all thy ways, he will direct our paths. Acknowledge him. And God bless you.
Did he not look resplendent in his African garb? Yes. You looking beautiful, Mr. Byrd. Has anyone in this room ever heard of the word Kuji Chakalia? Ashe, ashe. Kuji Chakalia is self-determination. Through self-determination, we can and do change who we are and how we live. We don't waste time blaming others for the world our thoughts have created. I said we don't waste time blaming others that the world our thoughts have created. Self-determining people look within to change the causes of their predicament so that the entire situation changes. Ah, Shay. We're talking about Mr. Cory L. Drummer. He is a person who embraces Kuji Chakalia self-determination. We're gonna sit up here and we're gonna lift this man up. Cory L. Drummer is the founder of the Fellowship Recovering Ministry, a support group for recovering drug addicts, alcohol, and others. As his sister Brenda notes, one of Cory's favorite sayings is that we're all recovering from something. Cousins, I said, we're all recovering from something. Ashe. Fellowship Recovery is a God-centered ministry. The group meets every Thursday from 7 to 9 p.m. at the Little Zion Baptist Church. Fellowship Recovery Ministry started as an act of hospitality by Cory in July of 1998. Conversation and a meal shared with a handful of recovering addicts was its genesis. Because you know that you are doomed to stay an addict unless you're in recovery. There is not enough recovery programs in the world. Ah, Shay. Don't get me happy up here, okay? Okay, the group provides a comfortable, safe, friendly Christian environment where people can come and talk about the struggles from their day-to-day life. After completion of Walden House Drug Recovery Program, Cory volunteered his time and many years of experience as a cook to CATS, a community service organization. I say ashe to every man that cooks. Every man that cooks, I give you my personal ashe. That's where a man belongs, in the kitchen, okay? Ashe. Don't get me started, okay? He proved to be a responsible, dedicated, reliable worker and was rewarded with a full-time permanent job. He's also been in the U.S. Army and he went to Vietnam. God bless you. God bless you. You went to Vietnam. Cory's life is a testimony to successful spiritual and physical recovery, because the two go together. You can't have one without the other. All right. He constantly works to give back to his family, his friend, and his community. Cory is a role model, not only for younger men and women in the community, but for all of us who've ever had any problem that we've ever tried to overcome. Cory, please come up here and let you no longer be unsung, because we're going to sing to you today, Cory. Ashe! Ashe. I tell you, we got such beautiful men here today. Woo!
First, I'd like to give thanks to God. I'd like to also thank all those, the sponsors and the founders of this Unsung Heroes Award. I'm a person that likes to talk, and right about now I find myself at a loss for words. I'm what Carl Anderson says, he used to say, I used to remember him saying when I was a little boy, and I think he still say it now when he say, what God can't do just can't be done. I'm one of those persons that thought that drugs and a life of crime was all that I would ever live, and I was satisfied with that. God pulled me to the side through some setbacks in my life and let me know that that wasn't what he had in store for me. I went into a recovery program, and I went in with the frame of mind that it was time for me to change my life. It was time for me to get things together. And I was listening to them say that I'm a role model, and that's kind of just, you know. But I have something to give. And when I was out on the streets, living in the corners, in the trucks, under the bridges, and all of those things, there were a lot of nice people that did a lot of nice things for me. And when I went back into treatment, I made up my mind that what I wanted to do more than anything else was just help somebody. And I say every Thursday night that if I can just help just one, you know, just one, then it's all worth it. 30 years of being an addict, 30 years of being in and out of prison, 30 years of not knowing whether I was going to live from the next moment to the next. So God is good. I thank God for my sister who submitted my name. I thank God for my mother. I thank God for my sisters and my nieces, my daughters. I thank God especially for my pastor who opened the doors to our church so that we could do this. And it's not just me that does it. I just kind of sit up front. But there are a lot of us, and I felt like in order for me to continue doing the things that I was doing and things that I wanted to do, I had to have some kind of structure that would remind me daily of where I come from. I cook for a cats organization. I cook at a shelter downtown, and I cook for about 1,000 people every day. And when I go to work in the morning, it's a reality check of for me of where I come from, where I've been, and where I don't ever want to go anymore. I thank God especially for my wife, who has been a part of my life for over 40 years. And somewhere along the line, she got the nerve to tell me that it was time, you know, to make a choice. You know, it was time for me, you know, to be her man, her husband, a father, something that I'd never been before in my life, or going about my business and just be a dope fiend, you know? So with that, I say thank you, thank you, thank you. I would have never imagined even being on the same stage with the mayor or any of the people that are on this plaque today. So I say thank you.
Cousins, my name is Veronica Dangerfield, and I started out life in Tokyo, Japan. I lived there until I was 10 years old, and then I graduated from Tokyo, Japan to Mount Pleasant, Texas. Ashe. I had a language problem because nobody in Texas spoke English. Okay. But anyway, one of the sanctuaries that I found growing up as a kid was the library. It was a place where I could always go. I always found love, because a book doesn't turn you down. I always found acceptance. A book is always available. And I found revenge, because a book told me about magic, and I turned everybody into toads and frogs. So I would like to collectively, all of us, put our hands together for the San Francisco Public Library. We got knowledge here. Unlimited. I want you to all say, I am loved. And I love you. I want you to say, I am beautiful. Because you are, and you are beautiful, and I love you. My name is Veronica Dangerfield, and I am the cheerleader for all heroes, whether you're unsung or not. Because in my heart, I know each and every one of you are a hero. And I thank you so much for the blessing of your presence today. And I'm going to pass on the baton to a young lady, the future generation, a leader of tomorrow, a beautiful, beautiful young girl. Her name is Tamika Davis. Give her all the love and support that you gave me. God bless you, and I love you.
Thank you so much, Veronica. Girl, you're just my inspiration. You're my inspiration. Although the amount of nominations is not a factor in choosing our unsung heroes, it has to be said that our next hero garnered close to 40 nominations. Gerald Hart has indeed touched a lot of people, young and old. As a painter for the San Francisco Housing Authorities in Petrel Hill, and before that in Sunnydale, Mr. Hart comes into contact with a lot of youth who are living and playing in unsafe conditions. He is therefore very concerned about their welfare and their future. Some of the youth who nominated him describe him as an honest and generous role model who genuinely cares about all people. And I say all people. They all recall the time he threw a party for them, paying for it with his whole paycheck. Whole paycheck. He also goes that extra mile to help residents who are in need of assistance, even if it's just lending them an ear. His supervisor, Wilbur Freeman, described him as a dependable and responsible worker who gives his time and support to the children and the community in which he works. Mr. Hart's wife, Carmen, describes him as a devoted husband and father who would often open his home to his nieces, nephews, and kids in the neighborhood, providing a safe environment for them to have fun. In her nomination, she wrote, and I quote, "Jerry is the second youngest of 13 children, and I can honestly say that he knows the meaning of sharing and giving. Because of the strong family-oriented background he has, Jerry has carried the way of life throughout his own life by giving back into the community in many ways. I have been able to witness Jerry give of his time voluntarily to kids in the neighborhood, giving time, money, and support. He worked for Jamestown Learning Center as a mentor for some of the most delinquent children in San Francisco. But in Jerry's eyes, this was not a problem, but a solution, because he was helping many of the children get focused and moving in the right direction. Jerry went as far as picking up certain children from their own homes in order for them to attend school. This is a man who gives and never asks for anything in return. I feel I was blessed to have someone in my life with such conviction for doing the right things and making life a little easier for others. I quote, please welcome our next unsung hero, Mr. Gerald Hart.
First of all, I'd like to thank God, my wonderful family, my wife, my two daughters. My wife that put up with me for 22 years, bringing people in and out of our house. Also, I'd like to thank Jimmy McNeil for acknowledging me at work and the staff at work that worked along with me. I'm kind of touched, so. My mother, who's out there, this go to you. Because it was you and Dad that raised 14 wonderful kids. So. And to all my friends and relatives, I love you. And just remember, all it takes is a little caring and a hug, a smile, and a tear. Thank you, and I love all you guys.
Victoria Morrison is employment and training coordinator at Tenants and Owners Development Corporation. For the outset of her arrival at TODCO, Victoria was determined to increase employment and training opportunities, not only to TODCO tenants, but to South of Market area residents. She has spearheaded a program called Division of One, which has achieved notable outcomes, including 75 participants and 40 employment or training placement in the last three quarters. Victoria provides workshops or resume development, cover letter writing, and interviews. When she observed that program participants lacked both interview and work wardrobes, Victoria organized ongoing clothing drives to present 41 individuals have received 324 donations, inclusive of two-piece business suits. Victoria is the impetus behind the netting of over 2,000 items and has facilitated distribution of the remaining goods to residents in need and to the South of Market-based community develop organizations. As Tyra Butler states, it is normal for Victoria's workday to extend from the very early morning until the late evening. Victoria says it is because she was taught to put something back into the community. Clearly, this philosophy has translated into selflessness and results-oriented approach that has quickly placed many low-income San Franciscans in jobs. Victoria only moved into San Francisco recently, but in a short time, it is obvious that she has worked very hard and is indeed an unsung hero in the African American community who has made life better. Victoria Morrison.
Oh. I have to tell you. Well, I'm here by myself, okay? Because my family's on the East Coast and I'm fairly new to San Francisco. So I am going to ask you to wrap your arms around me, okay? I have to tell you, I am so shocked at having won this award, given the fact that I have been in San Francisco exactly 12 months.
I'm sorry. I am just so happy. Okay, now let me tell you a little bit about the company I work for. It's the Tenants and Owners Development Corporation. It's located in San Francisco. I know many of you here have an activist background, as did I, and members of my family. That's how this organization started. This organization took no prisoners in making sure that there was low income and affordable housing for individuals in the South of Market area. It's one of the reasons that I accepted the offer to work with them, okay? It's really important that you work with folks that have your same ideals and same considerations. And so I'm very proud to be working with that organization. Now, there's a couple of reasons why individuals like ourselves work so hard. I'm sorry, I'm like, my voice is shaking, I'm sorry. And remember I told you that I'm gonna ask you to wrap your arms around me, okay? I'm gonna do something right now that I hope that y'all participate in, okay? Y'all gonna have to help me out, all right? I think that I can speak for everyone who is an unsung hero today by asking for you to participate in this process. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Why do you think we do what we do? Okay, why do you think that we work really hard in the community? Is there anyone? Stand up. Because what?
Because we love the community.
Okay, anybody else? We love the community.
We care about
them. You care? Please continue standing, the people. Anybody else? We care about the community.
Because we love people.
Because we love people. Anything else? Continue standing, please. Yes.
Because you want to give back what someone has given you.
Thank you. We also want to give back what someone's given us. Anybody else? Anybody else? The reason, yes, young lady.
Because we believe in God's work.
Because we do believe in the work of a higher power, no matter what his or her name. Okay? Anybody else? Okay, yes. We want to instill love in one another. Anything else? Anybody else? What the reason why, in my opinion, ew, we have a young man back here, yes. I didn't hear.
Justice.
Justice, very good. Young man, continue standing, continue standing. Anybody else? Yes. Beautiful hat.
To see a change
take place for the better. Absolutely. Anybody else? Yes, young man.
Peace.
Peace, yes. Continue standing. Anybody else? Yes, young man. Huh? I'm sorry.
Righteousness.
Absolutely. Yes. Stand up.
To
accommodate those that are less fortunate. Anyone else? I want to say that all of these individuals have excellent answers, okay? But I believe that one of the reasons, and the most important reason that we do what we do, is because we're having fun doing it. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
The selection committee of the Unsung Heroes received a nomination so heartfelt and impassionate that we invited the person who wrote it to introduce our next Unsung Hero. Please welcome the daughter of Levasta H. Patton, Ameenah Patton-Lutfee.
Good afternoon, everyone. I must say that I'm glad I brought my glasses, otherwise I'd have to ask my sister Marion, who's 11 months younger than me, to read this, but. Anyway, thanking everybody for coming out and saying hello to my parents, Mr. and Mrs. Patton. There's enough here, so I don't need to do any talking other than probably just reading what's here. Unsung hero. My father, Levasta H. Patton Sr., is truly an unsung hero. Although my father faced numerous challenges and achieved many accomplishments, throughout his hard work, his greatest gain not only improved his life, but the lives of countless others. During his employment at the Hunters Point Naval Shipyard from 1954 to 1974, where he worked as a welder, my father labored endlessly and sacrificed innumerable hours to eradicate institutional racism at the shipyard. The sacrifice took untold hours away from spending time with his wife and seven children. Not to mention that he maintained part-time jobs, both in the evening and weekends as well. My father's sentiments were, and I quote, "I don't want to open the gate. I want someone to remove the hinges." Without question, his diligence and commitment to this unchallenged pattern of discrimination led to my father taking the following actions. He organized minority workers to form an EEO organization. Levasta Patton served as the president. He established the first equal employment opportunity, EEO, in the United States at an employment site. Establishment of the EEO resulted in federal laws being passed which covered city, state, and federal employment laws. He was instrumental in developing the affirmative action policies and procedures. He focused on patterns of discrimination and not on individual cases. He met with both Secretary of Defense, who was then Secretary of Defense McNamara, and then Vice President Lyndon Baines Johnson to discuss solutions to equal employment opportunities. He interfaced extensively with Congressman Shelley at the time and worked closely with the Council for Civic Unity toward development of EEO and affirmative action. Mr. Patton met several times, my dad met several times with the Secretary of Defense, McNamara, to advocate for non-closure of the Naval Shipyard because of economic repercussions on both workers and the community. His influence resulted in the shipyard remaining open for an additional 10 years. He was successful in challenging bias testing of candidates. Testing, training, and promotion proved to be discriminatory and an overt strategy utilized for the elimination of black and minority candidates. At the time, there were extremely small number of blacks who were promoted or held supervisory positions because of the bias. He filed a lawsuit for the release of information through the Freedom of Information Act in 1973, and he won. His action set a legal precedent and established case law. Prior to the suit, the EEO information was considered to be confidential and inaccessible to private citizens. Levasta Patton suffered extensive harassment from both management and supervisors because of his efforts and his stand against discrimination and his fight for justice and equality. He experienced harassment, both concealed and blatant harassment, while being denied promotion, although he was qualified, while his every move was constantly monitored. Further, at one point during his struggle, a small minority of blacks who misunderstood his mission ridiculed him. My dad was so devastated and so hurt by the taunts and ridicules that he quit his job at the shipyard, but he returned after 1 year of absence. Although my father has served as my role model and my mentor, he has undoubtedly paved the way for countless others and opened doors for them as well. When I reflect on my father's life, who is now 79 years old, excuse me, I know that because of his vision, his dedication, and relentless sacrifices throughout this country, more equitable employment and hiring practices have been set into motion. Further, because of his other milestones and contributions, this country has become a more democratic place to live. My father, Levasta Patton, will always be my hero. Thank you for the opportunity to nominate my beloved father, Levasta Patton.
I have one problem. The police department saw me outside and say, where are you from? I said, I'm from Oakland. He said, how in the world did you come over here in San Francisco and compete in something like this and win? So I hope that the people over here in San Francisco will respect me because I lived in San Francisco. So let me say, I'm not gonna take long, but I'll tell you one thing that I felt like I had to do when I started this argument and fighting with the federal government, fighting with everybody else. I felt like that somebody had to do something about discrimination for people who qualified and was not promoted, was not even considered for promotion. So what I did, I decided that I was gonna file a complaint against the government, and I filed a complaint against the federal government, and everybody came out here to see me, and they tried to talk to me, and they did this, and they did that. So what happened is a lot of people don't know where EEO started. A lot of people said it started here, it started there, but my friends right here at Hunters Point, I didn't do it only by myself, I had a lot of help. We started the first EEO and set the precedent and the rules and regulations for EEO in every city, state, and federal agency. And the only thing that bothered me about it, when I first started and I got my adopted son down here, Mr. Frank Thomas, he'll tell you that I said, when we first started, I wanted the federal government to pass a law, just like the city has a law, if you park, you get a ticket, and if you speed, you get a ticket. There was no law ever passed, it was only a policy, that EEO was a policy. And what I said at that time, if you just have a policy, that eventually the policy can be erased whenever you get into the new administration. And I said that objects travel in a direction without a source of energy would eventually stop. And that's exactly what's almost happened with EEO and equal employment and affirmative action in this country. And I think that the young folks has to step forward, not those that's not qualified. We must get an education, we must go to school, we must learn, we must respect each other. And we also must not put your personal life in front of everything else. In other words, it comes a time when somebody has to do something, and I'm gonna tell you this little joke, and then I'm gonna be finished. The cat was eating up all the mice, and it said, Lord, what are we gonna do? And it said, I'll tell you what we'll do. We're gonna put a bell on that cat so that when we hear him come, we'll know how to run. They said, well, Lord, who's going to put the bell on the cat? Because when you put the bell on the cat, you're going to get ate up. But one little mice stepped forward, which was me, I guess, and stepped forward and put the bell on the cat and was eaten up. Now, when I say eaten up, I received no promotions. I received a very, very radical situation at the Navy Yard, and I suspect that I'm on the FBI files I'm not joking now. I suspect that I'm on the files of the FBI because they want to find something against me. And so what I'm saying again too is that what we have to do, it comes a time when you have to be willing to make the sacrifice. And before I stepped into this big deal that I got into, I told my wife, I said, look, I'm gonna take a stand on this. I might get fired, so I don't know what's gonna happen. I was working at Hunters Point. I was parking cars at night. I was meeting at night meeting with EEO and all this sort of stuff. Most of the time, my family, I would spend my time putting my clothes on, eating, and going to sleep at the same time. And I did this for God knows how many years, and eventually, we got EEO started. But now what I'm saying again, too, is the young folks now has to get an education. Now, I'm going to tell you something. My policy at Hunters Point was that if you do not have at least a high school education, I don't want you to appoint an unqualified person you can get rid of when you get ready. That we must develop an education. We must be able to produce in order for the man to pay you the money. He's not gonna pay you money if you can't produce. So what I suggest to the young people, go to school, get an education, be prepared to face whatever you have to face, and stand up for whatever you have to stand up for. Just make sure you're right and take a stand. If you're not gonna finish something, don't start it. So I'm very happy here. I'm very happy, and I'll tell you something, I was quite shocked when the lady called and left a message at the house. I said, I wonder what in the world do she want? I just couldn't imagine me being a citizen of Oakland and competing with all the people in San Francisco to receive this award. And I want to thank the people very much. And it wasn't just for me, as far as I'm concerned. This reward is shared with a lot of my co-workers to share today. And I want to thank them for being here. And thank you very much. Okay? Thank you.
I'd like to present our final presenter, Mr. Donald Ray Young.
Some of the folks left, unfortunately. But what that does, it means there's more food for you to eat afterwards. My name is Donald Ray Young. I'm an unsung hero of 1991, and I am very proud to be here. For those of you that have won, I know exactly how you feel right now. I cried, I rushed to the bathroom, I itched, and I scratched. Being an unsung hero has a lot to say about you. Some of your lives will never be the same again. So tell people that if you high energy, you do not need any drugs. If you get very tired sometime, rub, hold, or squeeze anybody that's close to you. I'm supposed to introduce a choir, a group of young people who are supposed to make us feel that there is hope because of our young people. So let's introduce them after they perform. Come on up here, children.
Oh.
voices of St. Mark's. The voices of St. Mark. It's a shame that Willie Brown had to leave. He missed a treat. You guys were good. I am sweaty up here from joy and happiness. For 11 years, we have wanted to see some young people perform in this building today on the last day of Black History Month. Give yourself a hand. Veronica, what are we supposed to say now? Ashe! Our next form of entertainment is an educational event. He has exhibits that he travels around the schools and the churches. He is into Black inventors. His name is R. I. Reed. May we give him a round of applause, please?
See, this is the reason why I go around juvenile hall, schools, libraries, everywhere, because there's very little information that's about Black invention in public schools. Some schools don't even have Black History Month programs. So I do a lot of research all the way back to the 1700s, 1800s. I think we should move on a little bit more from civil rights and slavery. They show that film to us every year. Well, I mean, can we move on?
Okay.
We have achievements. I have a big show, 70 inventions, but I only want to bring two for the sake of time. Sarah Boone invented the ironing board. She was the first woman to have an invention, okay? Well, this one right here doesn't have the support on it, but it gives you a little ideas, a little reproduction. And right here on this other side, this is a male inventor. That's a Morse code by Glenville Woods. When you take BART, look at the third rail. There's a third rail on this side. A Black man did that. When you ride them roller coasters, that's a Black man. Get on that elevator, Black man. I can go on down the line. So I'm not going to take a lot of your time. This is Larry Ware, by the way. He's a well-known poet across the country. But normally, I came in somebody's school here. I know that. And I went to Juvenile Hall last Friday. Man, I wanted to cry. But when they left, looked like they said they're going to do a little bit better. We did a show for 90-something kids up there. But I'm going to keep up this work. See, you know, I almost cried then when these kids were singing. That's who I catered to. So that's all I have for you. I know the show has gone, so thank you very much.
It is indeed an honor to present our next awardee, Miss Priscilla Wilder. And while I'm at that, Priscilla, your good buddy Gil Gordon told me to tell you hello and how proud he is of you, because he's an unsung hero too. Priscilla M. Wilder has been the director of the OMI Senior Center for the past 10 years. She has given countless hours of service in maintaining and improving the life of older adults and their families in the Ocean View, Merced, Ingleside area. Come on now, come on. According to Richard Ijoma, program analysis for the Commission on Aging, Her initiative, positive energy, and high self-esteem make her a role model for us all. She was the first African-American to open an import store in Jerry Durley Square. Eventually, she opened two additional stores in the Western Addition and the city of Vallejo. Is what you have on, is that show at your store, miss? Well, go on, show it off, girlfriend. She created a nonprofit organization, Provider United for Families, dedicated to providing technical assistance and support in the startup of family daycare homes. Her organization was responsible for establishing more than 20 licensed daycare homes in the Ingleside area. She's the mother of five children and has also dedicated time and energy to many civic affairs. She is currently the president of the board of directors for the Merced Heights chapter of the Lions Club International. Go right on. One of the nominators said it best. She is a very giving, caring, and loving person. She is at anyone's beck and call that needs her help. I know from experiences because she has really been an anchor in my life. Priscilla M. Walder, unsung hero of the African American community for 1999.
Thank you. Thank you for that applause. First of all, giving thanks to God and honor to God for making me one of his leaders, for leading me in the directions that I have gone over the years. I never shall forget. I was sitting reflecting while listening to all of the others. And I thought about myself and how and when I started on this journey. It was after my husband made his transition, and I was appointed by some of the African students from State University as the African ambassador. And when any other would come into the from different countries into the city of San Francisco, they would look me up because my name was passed on and on and down. So I recall there was an affair being held at the Pan-African House, and I tried my best to find an African attire to wear. I could not. So after that, I decided I know what I'll do. I'll write all of my friends in Africa and I'll open my own business. And this is what I did in the early 60s and 70s. I had the first African import store in the city of San Francisco. It was the first one in Ghirardelli. Thank you. Ashe. The first one in Ghirardelli Square. I recall they sent one of their members down from the board to my little store on Fillmore Street. And maybe some of you recall it. It was called Baite. Baite means hail to the chief. And I happened to see that name one evening while watching Channel 9. And they were singing Baite. I said, ooh. So anyway, that's how I got the name of Baite African Import. So after that, moving on from the African Import store, and by the way, the African Culture Center, which was on Fillmore Street when it first started, I did the displays there. And it gave my heart joy just to see the young people carrying on a tradition that my children did when they were coming up. They danced with a group called Amakoyanze, and they were doing African dancing, and that was a little before Danny Duncan. So you see, I'm going back a long, long ways, aren't I? Anyway, during those travels and those years, and health causing me to close my stores after about 7 years, and I had five children at that time, and one daughter was raising a child of her own. She found it very difficult to get quality care in centers. So, along with some of my peers, I decided, okay, we'll start a family daycare home. And what we did, we went out and we started going to Sacramento lobbying for licensed family daycare home, subsidized licensed family day, not just family, but subsidized. And along with some of them, we did acquire the first subsidized corporation here in San Francisco. It was called PUF, Providers United for Families. This gave a lot of parents, like my daughter, who was raising a child, the opportunity to have her child in a daycare home where she would not have to pay the full price. Later on, that was turned over to somebody else because I'm moving right along, you notice. And I'm still moving. And after being in with the family daycare home for so many years, I sort of got tired. So I took a break. And that break took me to Texas for 1 year. And I got there, I decided, no, this is not the place for me. Because being here, I was appointed by, at that time we had district election by, I think it was Lee Dolson, for the on the Child Care Initiative Program. And upon leaving, of course, it was a very sad day for a lot of them, so I was told. But what do? We keep on keeping on, right? Okay, and this is what I did when I returned from Texas. I relaxed for a while, and then I decided I'd go to the other end of the totem pole. I took a few courses in gerontology and went on into senior center. And this is where I've made my stand. And as I look back upon our mission statement, it says something to the effect of serving the needy, the sick, the shut in, the disenfranchised. And this is where I feel that I have had an impact, not only on the lives of others, but through the grace of God, I have had an impact on myself, and I see where the Lord is leading me. And what can I say other than I am so thankful? Because I'm looking every day at this little center and the support that I have received. And support is that's here supporting me. I want you to know that I could not have done it without you. There are so many faces out in that audience right now that I am looking at that are from the center that we work in. And I notice, I say we because it is we. It's a family affair, and this is what I always say. When anybody, a new one come in, I says, we're a family here. You're welcome. And as one of them so eloquently put it, in the mornings when they come in, I get my hugs and I get my kisses because we just never know how that person has lived, where they've been, and we'd never take anything for granted. Every day there is something going on. And when I see families, seniors now, that have given their lives, that come here, from all over the country, and they're living on their assets rich, and that's about the size of it. But I know that they're rich in their hearts because God has carried them. And I gotta stop now, because if I don't, I'm gonna start crying.
Yes, I will. Thank you. Come on, man. Mm.
But before I leave, before I move on, I must say, I want to thank my children for choosing me as a vessel for getting here into this world. Thank you.
How does one become an unsung hero? You have to be nominated. You are thoroughly scrutinized by the Unsung Hero Award Committee. I have been doing it for 8 years. And by not being on the committee, I could never nominate anybody. So when Amy called me and said, we need you to be the MC, I got my phone book out and I nominated a whole bunch of people. I will not discuss who I nominated that won, but one person did. And that was Mr. Jesse Byrd, who's had to leave. People talk about Jesse's cooking, but I met Jesse when I was on the Hart in the Black Community for the American Red Cross. And we gave gospel festivals every year. And Jesse was known for his barbecue greens. The brother can burn, y'all. I'm trying to get him to be a part of the men's auxiliary of the National Council of Negro Women so he can cook with them so that next year's affair will be so crowded that the young people are gonna take over of the old folks. Okay? I heard that one. Our next unsung hero is Miss Gloria Tynes. Miss Gloria was born in Shawnee, Oklahoma, and moved to California as a small child in 1944, the year I was born. She has lived in the Bayview for the past 15 years, where she volunteers her time to run the clothing bank at the Bayview Hunters Point Multi-Service Drop-In Center. Barbara Brown, the director of the center, describes Ms. Tynes as one of her most faithful, diligent workers who volunteers in spite of several chronic illnesses. Gloria worked for 25 years at Intel Corporation, where she retired on disability, is now living, as she describes it, on God's salary. I'm looking for that too. Not having to work and get some money. God's salary. Jesus. Besides working at the center, she also feeds the homeless every week at the Central City Hospitality House. She brings warm blankets and clothing to the streets during the winter months so that homeless people can stay warm. Gloria is also involved with underprivileged children. In order to show them a better way, she feeds and clothes them and brings them to church. Now, you know, that's the problem we have in the Black community. Our churches are not doing what they're doing because we don't take the children there to be there. So can this woman up here, Miss Gloria, be the one that calls you to take the children to church so some good things can happen? Ashe? Okay. Gloria is a member of the Perry Temple Church of God in Christ, and is assistant outreach coordinator of the Northern Chapter of the Gospel Music Workshop of America, which is a 600-voice mass choir that travels to different cities each year. Of course, you can find Gloria helping the homeless in these various cities as well. Gloria is the mother of 4 children, 9 grandchildren, one great-grandchildren, and another on the way. She is indeed a friend to many and deserving of this honor. Please welcome our unsung hero, Miss Gloria Tynes.
First, I'd like to thank God. I'd like to thank Barbara Brown and the United Council of Human Services for nominating me for this award. And I'd like to thank my family and friends for their support. I am so excited about receiving this award. I love the work that I'm doing. It is so rewarding to help others. When I first started working with the homeless and needy people, I had no idea of the impact that our agency, the United Council of Human Services, had here in San Francisco. I found out that all you have to do is open your heart up, and you'll find there's lots of room in there for others. When we look at the condition of less fortunate people, our heart becomes tender, knowing that if it was not for the grace of God, it could be us. The golden rule, do unto others as you have them to do unto you, is what I live by. Thank you.
There is no turf at the San Francisco Public Library. You have winners from Ocean View, Western Addition, Petrel Hill, Hunters Point. And that means that this should be on the news, on the news tonight. It should be on the cover of the Chronicle in the morning, the Examiner in the afternoon, because you had a whole bunch of black folks from the city and county of San Francisco and Mr. Patton from Oakland who came over here to have a good time. Can you guys give yourself a round of applause? There's a young man in the back who takes pictures. His name is Mr. Jamie Williams. He's been doing this for the public library since it started in 1989. He has a red shirt. He has a television show. Turn around and look at him, and he might get you on television. This is a treat. Our next unsung hero is Dr. Aurelius Walker. I didn't nominate him, but I like him too. Dr. Walker has been a resident of San Francisco for more than 40 years, born in Atlanta, Texas. They speak English in Texas. He came to San Francisco in 1954, the year I was born, and was called to the pastoral ministry in 1968, the year I was born. He is the founder and pastor of the True Hope Church of God in Christ, Inc., located in the Bayview Hunters Point community. All right, y'all, come on, give it to him. Give it to him. Dr. Walker has been deeply involved in the African American community. Did you just want to show off a suit? Let me finish. Let me get you up, boy. Now, where did I leave off? Okay, I got him. He is a co-founder and president of the board of directors for the Mission Possible Reentry House, a drug rehabilitation home. He formed the Bayview Hunters Point Job Coalition, which negotiated contractual agreements with unions and local businesses. I got to pat myself on the back for that one. He is the host of God's Word Ministry on television. In 1972, the year I was born, he was appointed chaplain at the San Bruno jail facility. He is the founder and organizer of the Spiritual Rehabilitation Ministry in the Men's and Women's Facility of the San Francisco Jail System. I'm sure a lot of you know him. He is the chairman. I do. He is the chairman of the board of directors for the Caring and Restoration Homes, Inc., designed for people with alcohol and drug abuse problems. He is the president of a development group which provides housing for middle and low income people. He is the executive secretary of California Northwest for the Church of God in Christ. This man is right on. Okay, that's power, prestige, control, and possibly some money. The San Francisco Board of Supervisors passed a resolution to rename Fetch Street to Aurelius Walker Drive. Got a street named after him. Do you know the beauty of that, folks? Martin Luther King had to die for streets to be named after him. Reverend Walker is alive. Okay? He is married and the father of five with a host of grandchildren. His daughter T, Walker Alexander, will now do a selection in honor of her father. Then we will welcome Dr. Walker to the podium. Come on, T. It's all yours.
For those of you, I am grateful to be here this afternoon to help honor my father. He is a great man, and I appreciate all the things that he has instilled in us as children. And I just want to dedicate his favorite song to him, How Great Thou Art. Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hand has made, I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder. Thou power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pastor Aurelius Walker.
Will the pastor, the chaplain, Dr. Walker, Unsung Hero, 1999.
Thank you. Thank you. I want to thank the Golden Gate chapter of the National Negro Women's, and also the Friends of the San Francisco Library, and Miss Leslie Ann Bedinga, who actually recommended my name, put my name in the running for this award. Is she here? Mrs. Bedinga, would you mind standing? She's way in the back there. Thank you, Miss Bedinga. Leslie Ann is from Gabon, Africa. I am a missionary. My wife and I are missionaries to Africa. We was in Gabon in 1994. We also was in Nigeria. I took about 20 people there in 91. We were the first African-American missionaries from America to that particular section of Nigeria. I want to thank also my family and for being here. Would you mind standing, families and members that came with me today, would you mind standing, please? Thank you very much. Thank God for my lovely wife. And I tell her she's my queen. Because every man's wife should be the queen. And I was in Nigeria. As a matter of fact, I was in Nigeria, and I spoke before some of the traditional rulers there in Nigeria. And I told them what I was going to do. I was going to make my wife the queen of Nigeria. They just smiled at me when I did that. I think this is real significant. I think it is important for us to be here this afternoon. I want to appreciate the committee for making the decision to recognize some of the contribution, not for my sake, but for the sake of those that I've been able to assist and help. Now, the one thing I want to bring to your attention about the MC, he confused me. Because every year he become older and older, younger and younger. I will not take up a lot of your time. I would just say that at this point in time, with the thing that I have done to try to make people's lives better in this city, we're in the process now of adding on about 9,500 square feet to our present church building, which is 6,000 square feet, which will give us a 15,500 square feet. Now, the purpose of that, one is we're going to have a child daycare center. The child daycare center will house anywhere from 75 to 100 children. Also, we're going to have a computer learning center, with which we can serve around 30 young people. My son-in-law here is with the Kaiser Foundation. He is an expert computer engineer, and my daughter's work in that particular area. Also, we're going to have a youth employment center there in that facility. And I'm so grateful and so thankful for this opportunity. Also, this definitely will encourage me to continue doing what I can to make San Francisco a better place for all people. My final comment will be, all of us know that practically all of the minorities in San Francisco are growing, they are developing, but unfortunately we are losing our African-American population. Not only are we losing them, crime and drugs. So that is why that we're committed. With those three homes, we can house up to about 30 people. What we do, we're connected with, community college there, Southeast Community College, whether we send them to the Southeast Community College to further their education. We're connected with other facilities. And I have one young lady that's with me here today, Sylvia Williams. Is she here? Is Sylvia still here? Stand up, Sylvia. Thank you, dear. This young lady came through our program, and she's back now in San Francisco State in a senior nursing program. And those are some of the things that we're doing with that program. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have a suit just like that. And I was going to wear it. But then I realized after the program, I was going to be hugged and kissed by so many women that I didn't want to get my suit damaged. So what you church people can do is show love to your minister and kiss him all over the suit so he will have to take it to the cleaners. Dr. Walker, God bless you. Amen. Our last awardee, I'm going to have fun with this one. I don't know why it took us so long. Martha Thibodeau is the founder, along with Joan Jackson, of the Unsung Hero Award ceremony. We have fought. We have loved each other. We have argued over who should win, who should not win. The lady does return calls. I do hope she has her shoes on, because this is the first time at any Unsung Hero Award that I would see Martha Thibodeau with some shoes on, because she's back there in the kitchen working. You know how you ladies don't like to cook with no high heels on. Okay. Joan Jackson of the Western Edition Library wrote what I'm about to read. Martha Thibodeau has been the unsung hero of the Unsung Hero Awards program. In 1989, the year I was born, the Golden Gate chapter of the National Council of Negro Women met at the Western Edition Branch Library. Martha as spokesperson, asked the group could help, how could they help the library? Together, she and Joan Jackson created, developed, massaged the Unsung Hero Award ceremony, which we have today, 11 years, y'all. We have come a long, long way. Thanks to Joan, and thanks to Martha. From the beginning, Martha was in charge of the buffet reception that is always the finale of the program. Each year she has organized a team. They shopped, they cook, they set up, they serve, and cleaned up after this event. Other NCNW members have also worked hard at the receptions, but Martha is the mainstay of the groups every year. Frankly, her family has been drafted to help her as well. One year, Martha had car trouble the day of the program. She and her sister arrived at the Western Addition Library with shopping carts heaped high with groceries, which they had purchased from Safeway four blocks away. It's sad that she can't do that now. Since I did that. I went to Safeway and had the little buggy, and I crossed that little yellow line, and it stopped right there on me. And for those of us who did not know that, we suffered. You caught that one, huh? They arrived with pans of food they planned to heat in the new state-of-the-art kitchen. This is here. Only to find that the stoves and ovens didn't work. This is this building we're talking about, people. All these millions of dollars. They spent the next 3 hours carrying food from the ground floor to the sixth floor to heat it in a small microwave oven. The staff lounge, okay? But when the hungry crowd arrived, the buffet was ready for them. That's why I'm introducing her last. So after she's done, we have a little thing left, and then the unsung hero stand up, take pictures, walk out, and then we eat. It's all that simple. Martha was also mainstay of the advisory group, which helped create the African and African-American History and Cultural Collection at the Western Addition Library in 1992. A year after my birthday. Her library activities are only one aspect of her community service. One of her early activities was the Baby Airlift Project. During the late 1960s, plane loads of orphaned Vietnamese babies were flown to San Francisco for care and adoption. Martha herself, a recent arrival in San Francisco, was among those who met the planes and helped care for the truly little newcomers. In 1979, Martha helped start the Children's Council of San Francisco, serving on its board for 6 years. With a grant from the city, she performed a variety of services to parents. An NCNW member since 1968, she founded the Golden Gate chapter in 1983, which now has over 200 members in San Francisco alone. Around the same time, she helped organize the National Immunization Project, which arranged health care services for single parents. Recently, she has been part of the annual Bethune Recognition Program, raising $25,000 for its national headquarters, has chaired the 1995 Quaker Oaks Awards Breakfast. I was at that breakfast last year. I am now a male member of the National Council of Negro Women, okay? Cause of Martha, even though the president got me. And last year, she chaired the NCNW program honoring Bay Area ministers. Since 1997, she has served on the national board of the National Council of Negro Women. She is married to Chris. her high school sweetheart. They have two daughters, Candace, who is now a medical student, and Christine, a student at Bethune-Cookman College. While raising a family, Martha earned an Associate of Arts degree in banking and management from City College of San Francisco. When Martha agreed to be nominated for, oh, you're gonna love this one. When Martha agreed to be nominated for this award, she had two conditions. One, if she got an award, she said she wanted to receive it during the middle of the program. That didn't happen. Second, she insisted that Donald Ray Young introduced her. So I'm doing that. So that she could be in the kitchen when she was needed to help with preparations for the reception. She has always been behind the scenes. She is a Renaissance woman. She can bust them pots, work with children, make seniors very happy. It is time to introduce not Oprah, but Martha Thibodeau. Martha, Martha, Martha! And she has on heels.
Giving honor to God and to the friends of the San Francisco Library and to all the friends and families that are here today, it's truly an honor to receive this award. You know, we are all unsung heroes in our rights. We just are not recognized. And this program comes from the heart. And I want to give special thanks to Joan Jackson. I hope she's still here. The past librarian of the Western Addition Library. Would she please stand? Wherever she is. Joan is a vital part to the Unsung Hero program. And when she came to the National Council of Negro Women, we were ready to take it on. You know, I usually sat on the advisory committee choosing unsung heroes. So it was a dilemma whether to sit on the advisory committee or receive the award. But Joan coaxed me, and with some other friends, I think I was ready to accept it. And I really, really feel glad, and I'm very, very proud of this program because it leaves no one behind. And it is a theme of the National Council of Negro Women not to leave no one behind. And this is what we're planning to do throughout the year. We have a drive to secure more members, whether they're men or women. You know, we are the organization that everything that comes through from national, and when I mean national, I'm talking about Washington, D.C., concerning black families, comes through the National Council of Negro Women. About a couple of years ago, 1997, we purchased the most beautiful building on the Pennsylvania Avenue. We are the only African-American owners on Pennsylvania Avenue. Located between the White House and the Capitol. And you know, they know we are in town because our reception the next morning, they found ham hocks and greens in the garbage. We forgot to call the garbage man that day. See, we weren't homeowners or landowners at that time, so we forgot to notify the right people. But all that aside, please be advised that the National Council of Negro Women stands for you, and they speak for you. Our national president emeritus, Dorothy I. Height, is always working, and she's the last of the civil rights leaders still working. So I behoove you, and I'm asking you to please join the National Council of Negro Women. We only charge $25 a year. And this year, we got a special drive. And we need all of you,
all of you to help pay for this building. See, we don't want to lose this building. And as long as we have you on our roster and our roles working in the community, we're going to do very good. So I'm going to like cut this short and say once again, thank you so very much. And it's an honor.
You have met the 10 unsung heroes of 1999. Will you please stand? Will the unhunts stand? I hope this day will be a small moment in your life for the rest of your life. We love you. You deserve it. Be proud of it. Brag about it. Show it off. If it's ever in any type of paper, buy gobs of them and send them all over the country and say, I was an unsung hero for 1999. It's been nice. Joan Jackson, the founder of the library, would you please come forward? Joan Jackson is the founder, with Martha Thibodeau, of the Unsung Hero Award. At one time, only us in the Western edition received this award. But during the 10-year period, people have been getting it all over the city. And as you can see this year, they have gotten it from Ocean View, Ingleside, Merced, Petrel Hill, Hunters Point, Bayview, and the Western Addition. Joan is retired now, but she's a hell of an editor. She's a wonderful writer. She loves the library. She, in turn, causes me to carry in my pocket at all times. Now I see Nordstrom's. I do have a library card, John. I really do. And I'm hoping that each of you will sign up for the library. It's free. Another thing that you must know about the library, every activity that this group of people give, the librarians like Amy, Linda, Darkus, Dorothy, they're all free. So, you know, it's nice to feel good and go someplace where you can be around some happy-go-lucky people, and it's free. Miss Jackson, would you please enter the stage? Some ladies want to give you something.
I was introduced earlier. I'm Linda Brooks Burton, the manager at the Bayview Library in Bayview Hunters Point. I'd like to also introduce the committee for the Unsung Heroes. Come on up to the stage. These are all women who have worked with us, plus there are a few women here from the Council of Negro Women who have done the buffet today. Giving their props. I'd also like to introduce Dorothy Coakley, who is now the head of the Ocean View Library in Ocean View.
Building tomorrow, one kid at a time.
That's right. And Amy Holloway, who works here at the main library in the African American Center. And she has really put this, I have been out on maternity leave, so she had really put this program together almost single-handedly. I'm only helping out this year. Amy. She's taken over. And Joan? I have a proclamation here from the mayor that I'd like to read to Joan Jackson.
Oh, wow.
Whereas the city and county of San Francisco traditionally honors individuals and organizations that have achieved excellence, and whereas I am proud to commend Joan Jackson for her 35 years of dedicated service to the San Francisco Public Library and for enhancing the lives of hundreds of patrons, and whereas since 1989, Joan Jackson has brought the community an honored annual tradition, the Unsung Hero Award celebration, and whereas Joan Jackson continues to give unselfishly of her time and energy to make life better for all, and her leadership and commitment is already dearly missed. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Willie L. Brown, Jr., Mayor of the City and County of San Francisco, in honor of Joan Jackson's outstanding civic and community contributions, do hereby proclaim February 28, 1999, as Joan Jackson Day in San Francisco.
I was sitting there in the back row and thinking, this is the first program that I haven't been up and running around and have to come up on the stage and so on, and I'm enjoying it so much. So here I am anyway. But I have to say, I did enjoy this. I think this was the best Unsung Heroes program. And this is just beautiful. I thank you so much for this. And you know, when the mayor was here earlier, I stepped on some feet and I ran out there and I got his autograph on my program, and I didn't know that I was going to have his autograph right here on this. I can put up on my wall, and I shall. I was thinking about when Veronica Moyston spoke about why do people do the things they do for others. And she ended by saying, we do it because it's fun. And I want to tell you that every minute I have spent working on this program since 1989 has been so much fun. And meeting, getting to know the heroes every year, the incredible people every year, has been one of the great experiences of my life. I feel very, very lucky. So I think I'll leave you with one last thought, another quote from myself this afternoon, whispering in the back row. I was looking at the crowd and I was thinking how we started doing this in 89. We did it on a Saturday afternoon. We did it in Western Edition Branch, which is just a little medium-sized branch. We pushed tables around, you know, put some chairs up, and it grew and it grew. And I'm thinking now, probably next year, we'll have to go for Bill Graham Auditorium in this place. Wonderful. Thank you very much. Very much.